Let's take the first problem. A hot rolled steel has a yield strength of SYT is equal to SYC is equal to 690 MPa. So yield point is given. And a true strain at fracture, that is epsilon F, is equal to 0.55. Okay. Estimate the factor of safety for the following principal stress states. All the stresses given are in megapascal. So it's given 5 cases. Okay. And each cases he has given 3 principal stresses. We don't know which one is sigma A or sigma B he has given. So he has basically solved this equation, that is sigma cube minus I1 sigma square plus I2 sigma minus I3 is equal to 3. So he has solved and he got 3 values, and these 3 values are given in the table here. Okay. Now he has not even mentioned what theories of failure is to be used. So that we have to use our common sense to deduce. Now there are clues here in this problem. One is, he says it has got a yield point. So clear point value is 690 MPa. That means it is clearly defined yield point values available. That means it's a ductile material. Point number one is a ductile material. Second clue is, he says the strain at fracture, that is failure strain, is 0.55. So 0.55 is much larger than 0.05. So what is this 0.05? Usually as an engineering practice, we take whenever the strain is more than 0.05, we say the material is ductile. If the strain is less than 0.05, we say material is brittle. So these two data indicate that a material, that hot rolled steel, is a ductile material. So in ductile materials, we have studied three theories. One is distortion energy theory. Another one is maximum shear stress theory, and the third one is ductile Coulomb Moore theory. So among these three, which one is applicable to this is a question again. Now if you look at the another clue in this problem, he is saying SYT is equal to SYC. That means this material behavior in tension is same as behavior in compression. That means it's a even material. So if it is even material, then you can use one of the basically you can use two theories. One is distortion energy theory, another one is maximum shear stress theory. Only in case the material is uneven, you can go for ductile Coulomb theory. So in this case, it's just a even material, so we'll use the only distortion energy theory and maximum shear stress theory. Now let's come back to the distortion energy theory. The distortion energy theory is very simple. The condition is, for failure to occur, or the limiting condition is, sigma 1 minus must be equal to sigma yield point, and if you want to make it as a design equation, u divided by n. So this is it. All we have to do is, from the principal stress, you find out what is the sigma 1, and sigma 1 should be compared or equated to yield point by n. So by doing this, we will get the factor of safety. Now let us take the first case. First case, we have three principal stresses. Before we get into that, let me discuss one more aspect in this. Out of the 5 cases given here, if you observe, in first 4 cases, there is a 0 value, 0, 0, 0, 0. That means what? Only 2 are non-zero values. So, therefore, we can conclude that from this diagram, that first 4 states are 2D stress states, okay? Whereas the last one is a 3D stress state. So accordingly, we can modify the equation, or we can use the simpler equations. Now we have seen in the discussion of distortion energy, 1 minus stress general equation is this. Okay, this is your 1 minus stress equation. This is for 3D. 3D is also applicable to 2D. However, if you know very well that it is a 2D case, you can use a relatively simpler equation. So whenever one of the stress principal stresses is 0, the 1 minus stress is given by this equation, this one. Okay, that is sigma 1 is equal to square root of sigma A square plus sigma B square minus sigma A into sigma B. If you don't remember, that's okay. You can always remember this equation, that is relatively easy. Okay, so let's go to the first case. First case is given the values 483, 483 and 0. Okay, so that means sigma A is 483, sigma B is 483. And of course, sigma c is equal to 0. So either you can use 3D equation or 2D equations, because I know very clearly that this is a 2D case. I'll prefer to use this first equation, that is sigma 1 is equal to square root of sigma a square plus sigma b square minus sigma a sigma b. Okay, so I'm not going into detail of every step. So in case you want to see, just pause the video and make a note of these steps. The first case, yes, I've substituted in the 1 minus stress equation, and this is your 1 minus 483 is 1 minus is equal to sigma yp by n. So you'll have this part. Okay, solve for n, that is nothing but factor of safety. Okay, the same procedure is repeated for second case also. So when it comes to third case, again it is similar. Fourth case also is similar, because only two values are there, two non-zero values, one is zero. So the interesting part is in the fifth case, it's a 3D for sure, because we have all the three components. So sigma a, sigma b and sigma c, all are there, and they are all equal to 207. So when you substitute in this, you will find out 1 minus stress is equal to 0. So if you remember well, 1 minus stress is also, 1 minus stress is an indication of distortion in the body. In this case, the loading is, the principal stresses are all equal to 207. That means it's a hydrostatic loading case. Here we will find only increase in the size of the specimen. There will not be any distortion. There will not be any change in shape. So naturally, the 1 minus stress will be 0. So therefore, the factor of safety will be infinity when you substitute in this. Okay, that's about it. So thus we have solved the factor of safety for all the cases. Now the next important method is using maximum shear stress theory. So what is maximum shear stress theory saying? So it's if you are, the first condition is, in maximum shear stress, it's very important you arrange all the stress component in this equation. Sigma 1 is greater than or equal to sigma 2 is greater than or equal to sigma 3. So that finding maximum stresses becomes very simple. So just use this equation straight away. That is sigma 1 minus sigma 3 is equal to sigma yp by n. That's all you have to do if you arrange. Otherwise, if you don't arrange, then you have to again find out sigma 1 minus 2, sigma 1 minus sigma 2 by 2, sigma 2 minus sigma 3 by 2, sigma 3 minus sigma 1 by 2, and then among these three values you have to find the maximum. So always prefer, whenever you are using maximum shear stress theory, first and foremost step is to arrange the values in decreasing order. So if you look at the given data, it is given first case as 483, 483, 0. So no issues, because they are already arranged. Okay. Whereas if you look at the second case, okay, 207, 483, 0 is a given value. So this needs to be arranged. Okay, the maximum should come first. So it should be arranged as 483, 207, 0. So that's what I have written here. Okay, this is the second case. Second case, I have rearranged this so that this already at the top I have written sigma 1, sigma 2, sigma 3. So this is the arranged table. So this table is arranged one. So therefore, you can directly take sigma 1 minus sigma 3 is equal to sigma L point by n. You can use this equation. So all you have to do is this. So first problem is straight away clear. 483 minus 0 is equal to 690 by n. It's clear. Second is also similar. And third, I just have to add one more point. The sigma 1 is 483 in third case, minus of minus 207. Okay. So because the sign of sigma 1, sigma 2, sigma 3 has to be retained. So that is equal to 690 by n. So minus of minus, it will become plus. So therefore, you will get factor of safety is equal to 1. And similarly, you can try with the third, fourth case. Fourth case, the maximum stress is 0. Yes, maximum stress can be 0 because other two stress components or principal stress components are negative because they are in compression, minus 207, 483. So I have arranged this again in decreasing order. So in this case, sigma 1 is 0, sigma 3 is minus 483. Therefore, you will get this step, fourth step. 0 minus of minus 483 is equal to 690 by n. So you can get factor of safety. And the last case, so we will have 0, that is maximum shear stress will be 0. And when you substitute, you will get a factor of safety as infinity. So after we solve all the problems, so we summarize the factor of safety in a table. So quickly, let's run through once. So we have given data, distortion energy equation. We have solved each case, all the 5 cases, and then we went to maximum shear stress theory. We first rearranged them, and after rearranging them, we just use this equation sigma minus sigma 3 is equal to sigma yp by n, and then solve for n. We got the final answer. That is the problem 1. So let's go to the second problem. Second problem says, a steel with yield point stress of 353 MPa is subjected to the following applied stresses of sigma x is 150 Newton per millimeter square, sigma y is equal to 100 Newton per millimeter square, and tau xy is equal to 50 Newton millimeter square. Find the factor of safety using maximum shear stress theory, Encke-Meisser theory, and maximum principal stress theory. So if you recollect, ideally speaking, we should be using only maximum shear stress and Encke-Meisser theory because it has got a yield point, it's a ductile material. So, however, sometimes you may also ask what will be the prediction based on maximum principal stress. Okay. So, let's try to solve this. First and foremost step in solving problem is to convert all the units into SI system. Okay. So, here we have that given data, yield point is given as 350 MPa. So, no issues. MPa basically means 10 per 6 pascals. And before we get into that, let me quickly summarize. Usually, we start with load, okay, and then we get stress, and then we get applied stress, principal stress. So, these are applied stress only, okay. This is principal stress. From principal stress, you will get the theories of failure. So, the previous problem, we were at this level. So, directly he had given the principal stresses. So, from there we went to theories of failure directly. But in this problem, he has given applied stress. He wants us to calculate principal stress. From principal stress, he wants us to calculate the factor of safety using theories of failure. Okay. So, that is the basic idea. And let's come back to the data. He has given sigma x, for example, is equal to 150 Newton per millimeter square. So, this is not a 100% SI system. So, this has to be converted into 150 into Newton. Millimeter square is 10 power minus 3 square. That turns out to be 150 into 10 power 6 Newton per meter square. Okay. So, which is nothing but 150 MPa. Okay. So, at least you can remember a rule that whenever you get a Newton per millimeter square, this is equivalent to MPa or 10 power 6 Pascal. So, I will always be using the units in terms of SI system only. So, therefore, 150 Newton per millimeter square turns into 150 MPa. Similarly, sigma y is 100 Newton per millimeter square becomes 100 MPa. And tau xy is 50 Newton per millimeter square becomes 50 MPa. Okay. Okay. Now, let's relook into the problem. Okay. Given problem, it's a 2D nature. Okay. There is a stress element like this. Okay. In this stress element, sigma x is given, sigma x is equal to 150 MPa, and sigma y is given, sigma y is equal to 100 MPa, and tau xy is also given, this tau xy is equal to 50 MPa. So, these are the applied stresses. From this, you have to find out the principal stresses. Okay. So, next step is to find out principal stresses. Because it's 2D, we will use the famous equations, that is sigma a comma b. Many times you will write this as sigma 1 comma 2 also, but I am deliberately using this notation because a comma b are in planar principal stresses. Okay, so sigma x plus sigma y by 2 plus or minus square root of sigma x minus sigma y by 2 square plus tau square xy. So here sigma x is given, okay, known, sigma y is known, and tau xy is also known. So, I am not writing 150 into 10 power 6 because all the values are in MPa. So, directly I will substitute given value and I get sigma a comma b is this and sigma is 180. So, after I get the value, I will add 1 MPa to this. So, units are important. This step from here 125 plus 55, 55 and 125 minus 55, you will get sigma a and sigma b. So these are the principal stresses. So from applied stress we got the principal stresses. These two are in planar principal stresses. Now there is one more principal stress, which is obviously sigma c is equal to 0 because it's 2D state. Let's use the distortion energy theory. It's very simple. As usual, sigma 1 is equal to sigma yp by n. So because it's a 2D, I'll use the 1 vs stress for equation pertaining to 2D, relatively simpler. Okay, when I substitute sigma a sigma b, I'll get 1 vs stress as 158.1121, and 353 is your yield point, all are in megapascal, so I don't have to worry. So straight away substitute, I'll get a factor of safety as 2.2642. Of course, there is also equation to find out 1 vs stress directly without finding the principal stresses. I have just added here. When you substitute this also, you will get the same value, but I am not doing that anyway. So now we will use maximum shear stress theory. So here arranging is required. Okay, we have got sigma 1, sigma 2, and the third one is 0. I have already arranged in the decreasing order. So this is sigma 1, this is sigma 2, and this is sigma 3. So the reason we are arranging is the calculation becomes simple and straight away. Therefore, I can directly write sigma 1 minus sigma 3 is equal to sigma yp by n. This equation, take sigma 1 from this, take sigma 3 from this, sigma 3 is 0. So we will get a factor of safety as 1.9512. So that's all it is. That is the end of second problem. So let's go to the third problem. So in third problem, he says it's a next level problem. Rather, you see, in the first problem, directly principal stresses were given. In second problem, applied stresses were given. In third problem, loads are given, not even applied stresses. Okay. So load, from load we will find out stress. From stress we will find out principal stress. From principal stress, we'll go for theories of failure. So let us look into the problem. Okay, a rod of circular cross section is subjected to a torsion of 300 kN. Okay, so torsional load is given, which is 300 kN, and a bending moment of 200 kN. Okay, and he wants us to select the steel with yield point as 353 MPa. Okay, and he is given factor of safety. So factor of safety is given. Now we have to find out what is the diameter of the rod so that the component won't fail according to these four theories, that is MSS, DE, total energy theory, and maximum normal stress theory. Okay, let's try to look into this in detail. Now there is a rod, okay. There is a rod, and this is subjected to a torsional load of 300. So a torque is applied whose value is 300 kN, that is 10^3 N, and a bending moment is also applied. So bending moment M applied both sides, bending moment is equal to much 200 kN is applied. Okay, so when this is applied, we want to find out somewhere here what is the stress and whether it has failed or not. From the formulas, you know, this is, you can take out this an element, and this will be subjected to a shear like this, and a bending moment. A bending moment will produce a normal stress. So this will be sigma x and this is tau xy. Okay, so we'll use the formulas to calculate this. We remember the sigma is equal to mi by a. M is applied bending moment. I'm using 10^3, okay, because it's a kilonewton. So this is kilo, and the radius, the distance from the center, will assume the element to be at the surface. This y will be d by 2, and moment of inertia, that is pi by 64 d power 4. So when you substitute, you will get this value. This is your sigma x. And because of bending, you got a normal stress along x direction. Okay. And because of torsion, you will get a shear stress. So torsion is again 300 into 10 power 3. Because it's kilo again, d by 2 into pi by 32. So here, polar moment of inertia to be used. Here, just moment of inertia to be used. So it's pi by 64 d power 4 there. Here it is pi by 32. When you substitute, you will get this. Now there is no sigma y acting because there is no bending which is trying to compress in vertical direction. Okay, this bending is trying to compress in the horizontal direction. So you will have normal stress in horizontal direction. So therefore, sigma x exists, but there is no bending that is happening in vertical direction. Okay, so there is no sigma y there. Okay, so now we can find out principal stress. Now that we know sigma x is known, sigma y is 0, and tau xy is known. So sigma x exists, sigma y is 0, and tau xy exists. So let's substitute in the principal stresses equation. Principal stress equation we already know, sigma here, sigma x plus sigma y by 2. Because sigma y is 0, it will directly become sigma x by 2. Okay. So same thing here. This is tau xy upon simplification. So this plus or minus to be remembered here. Simplify further. Okay, you will get sigma a and sigma b. Please remember, the sigma a and sigma b are now in terms of unknown variable dq. Okay, this one is unknown because diameter is not given. In fact, that's what we are trying to find out. Okay, and let's choose the theory. That is, first we'll use maximum shear stress theory. Maximum shear stress theory can be used when you arrange them in proper order. Okay, like that. So here I am arranging it. If you look at this value, sigma a and sigma b, so the maximum value is this. Okay, that I am putting it as a first. And please remember, the second value is actually going to be sigma 3 because there is 0 here. Where is this 0 coming from? Because this 0 is out of plane principal stress. So even though you are calculating only two principal stresses, there is always one out of plane principal stress which is 0 in case of 2D. So therefore, that comes here. So the arrangement is like this: sigma 1 is greater than sigma 2 is greater than sigma 3. So this has got positive value, this is positive, this has got negative value, and 0 comes in between. So therefore, this one becomes sigma 1, this becomes sigma 3. So naturally we'll use this equation, this substitute and solve for dq. You will get d to be 0.3148 meter, which can be written as approximately 315 millimeter. Okay, now let's go for distortion energy. So here the one minus stress, the equation still remains same, sigma 1 is equal to sigma yv by n. Only thing is, I will be using one Mises equation which is relevant only for 2D, because I know this case is a 2D nature. So, I will substitute sigma 1 Mises. Okay. This value is sigma 1. This entire thing. Okay. So, when you solve this, this entire thing left hand side is sigma 1 Mises, and it is in terms of d, okay, because it's d cube, and this right hand side is your sigma 8 point. I have written 10 power 6. Remember, I will always use SI system. So 353 into 10 power 6 pascals, and this 3 is your factor of safety. So this is from here, okay, and then you solve for d cube, will get a value of 0.02838 meters. Okay, that can be converted into millimeter as 304 mm. So these two are important theories, of course, just because he has asked in the problem, we'll try to solve using the total energy theories also. Total energy theory is given by this equation. Okay, sigma a is given, can be calculated in terms of d, sigma b can also be calculated. And nu, I think he has given nu, right? So nu in this problem, that is Poisson's ratio, it's not given Poisson's ratio, then in that case we'll take Poisson's ratio to be 0.3. Nothing is given, Poisson's ratio will be 0.3. So that's what we have done here. Yeah, this is 0.3. We have used 0.3 here. So solve for this. Okay. Only unknown is D. On solving, you get this. In case you have doubt, you can pause the video and just note it down. So we'll go for maximum normal stress theory. So it's important you remember the equation. So maximum normal stress is very simple. Sigma 1 is equal to sigma yield point by n. So sigma 1 we already found out, yield point is given, n is given, solve for d. So that will be around this 290 mm or 0.2894 meter. So in this problem, to summarize, we had given loads. From loads we found out stress, of course, in terms of d, which was a function of d. From stress we found out principal stress, and then we used theories of failure. So the flow is to be remembered. First problem we had directly principal stress, second problem we had applied stress, and this problem we had load. So problem can be given in any of these stages. If load is given, you have to find out stress. If stress is given, from there you find out principal stress. If principal stress is given, you can directly use theories of failure in that order. So let's take another problem. Okay, let's erase other things. This problem is similar to the previous one, except that diameter is given and factor of safety is asked. So it's just reverse engineering of the previous one. So diameter is given 60 mm, that is 16 to 10 power minus 3 meter. It's a steel shaft. It is subject to bending moment. Bending moment is given. Okay. And a torque is unknown. Is given torque as T. So that is what you have to find out. Yield point is 230 Newton per millimeter square, which is MPa, and find the maximum of torque without causing the yielding. Okay, and is given factor of safety also, that is 1.5. Okay, that's okay. So diameter is given as 60 mm, that is 0.06 meter. Bending moment is 25 into 10 power 5 Newton millimeter, which turns out to be 2500 Newton meter. So it's very important to always convert into SI system. Yield point is 230 Newton per millimeter square, that is 230 MPa, basically 230 into 10 power 6 Pascals. So I always prefer SI system. So this rod, if you look at this rod, subject to bending moment and torque T. Torque T is unknown, bending moment is known, diameter is given, which is also known, factor of safety is known. You just have to find out what is the value of T so that the component won't fail. So when you, the loading is of this nature, you will find only sigma in this case, because of bending sigma x exists. Okay, because of torsion you have tau xy. Okay. And there will not be any sigma y because there is no applied force in y direction. Okay. So let's go back, find out sigma bending stress is given by Mi by I. M is 2500 Newton meter. That's all. I am using SI system. And y is d by 2. So d is 0.06 meter. So that is 0 d by 2. And moment of inertia is pi by 32 e power 4. So pi by 32, 0.06 power 4. You will get this. Similarly, shear stress can be found out using torsion formula TR by IP. T is unknown, I will keep it as it is. Diameter is radius, that is diameter by 2 is radius, so 0.06 by 2 and pi by 32 d power 4. So when in case of torsion, please remember it is pi by 32. Okay, d power 4 is remains same both in bending as well as in torsion. Only thing, the value is 32 here. So when I substitute, I will get the shear stress in terms of T, because that is unknown. The next step, once we know the applied stresses, we'll find the principal stresses using the standard formula. Okay. Only thing is sigma x is clearly known, but sigma y is not known because it's not applied, so it is 0. And this tau xy is now a function of t, because that is not known. Okay, so when you substitute, you will get principal stresses sigma a and sigma b. So there is some trick here. I will try to write this sigma a is plus or minus something, okay, this entire thing. Okay, so we remove this for the time being. Sigma a is m plus n, sigma b is m minus 1. Because of plus or minus 1, you will get this. So, m is this portion, 58.945 into 10^6. N is this. The reason I do it is, it becomes simpler. By looking at this, because sigma a involves plus and sigma b involves minus, sigma a will turn out to be positive, whereas sigma b will turn out to be negative. Think about this. If you look at this equation, here 58.945 square plus some additional thing, and it's equal to again 58.945 square. So because of this something, okay, some additional value, the left hand side will always be more, so that m will be definitely more than n. Besides, there is a plus sign, so we'll get m plus n is sigma a, m minus 1 is sigma b. Okay, now, so we know sigma a is positive, sigma b is negative. And because it is 2D, there is always another stress which is 0. So the 0 will come in between. So therefore, sigma a will be positive, which is greater than 0, which is greater than sigma b. So this is positive, this is negative, 0 will come. So therefore, this will be sigma 1, this will be sigma 3. Therefore, we will rearrange that. We will use the maximum shear stress theory. This I'm using m and m so that some terms gets cancelled, so that I can simplify. This is sigma 1, this sigma 1 is m plus 1, sigma 3 is m minus 1. So you can m plus n minus m plus n, so this m get cancelled, n is 2n, so this side is 2n. This is given, okay, 230 into 10^6. 10^6 is because of megapascal have converted into 10^6. N is 1.5. So solve for N. Okay, N you get. Okay. So N contains T, and then solving for T, you will get T value to be 2079 Newton meter. That's the maximum torque that you can apply without failure, as predicted from maximum shear stress theory. So we can go ahead and try to use this equation, these values in case of distortion energy theory. Because it is 2D, we will go for the 2D form of von Mises stress. This is it. Okay. I have already written sigma a in terms of m plus n and sigma b in terms of m minus 1. That becomes handy here also. Okay. When you substitute in von Mises stress, sigma a, this m plus n is basically nothing but sigma a. This m minus is basically sigma b, sigma a into sigma b. Okay, so some terms gets cancelled here. We'll end up here with this term. This, once you simplify to the best possible form, we'll again write m in terms of t and n also in terms of t. So that's what we have. Of course, m is directly known, there is no need. Substitute here. You are still finding one Mises stress. So one Mises stress. So this entire thing is your one Mises value. So now this has to be equal to sigma yb by n. Simple. Let's go to the next step. Yeah. Sigma, this is your original equation. Now I'm deliberately making a small change. I'm trying to square them, so that because sigma 1 is in terms of root, so by squaring it will become easy for me. So sigma 1 is equal to sigma yp by n, I square it so that it becomes sigma 1 square is equal to sigma yp square, but n square. Okay, so this term substituted, because I'm squaring, this 10 power 6 becomes 10 power 12. Okay, this is 10 power 12, and that term, whatever is there inside the square root, will be as it is, because the square and root get cancelled. We'll have this. Okay, this is it. So, in the similar fashion, we can use this equation for maximum principal stress. Sigma 1 is now in terms of T. Substitute here, solve for T again. Okay, we will get torque to be 312643 Newton meter. Now we will go to the fifth problem, which is also similar. So I'll just run through this. So again, he's asking for the diameter. He was asking what is the diameter required. So what is given? Torsional load is given. T is given. Okay, bending moment is also given. Okay, he wants us to find out diameter using maximum shear stress theory, octahedral shear stress theory. This octahedral shear stress theory is nothing but distortion energy theory or von Mises theory. So you can use any one name for it. And the material has 300 MPa as tensile yield strength and 180 MPa as shear yield strength. Okay, there is one important thing is, okay, when while discussing in a theory, especially for maximum shear stress theory, the first point I told was, if the shear strength is available, you can directly use this shear strength. Only if you don't have it, then you can go for sigma yp by 2. Okay, so that's a one additional point in this particular problem. So other things remain same. Okay, so you got bending stress, which is sigma x, shear stress calculated, and from the these are applied stresses are known. So this is 2d case, sigma x is known, and we have this shear stress because of torque, and sigma y is anyway 0. So we are finding in planar shear principal stresses. It's not shear, it is principal stresses. Okay, so you got these sigma a and sigma b, these are the in planar principal stresses, and of course, because it's 2D, the out of principal stress is 0. Okay, so we'll rearrange them in that form. Okay, sigma 1 is greater than sigma 2 is greater than sigma 3. So that's all it is. Now, only special thing here is while using maximum shear stress theory, the equation, we'll use the original equation. Okay, until now, we were using equation sigma 1 minus sigma 3 is equal to sigma yp by n. So, whenever the tau yp is not available, then you can go for this. Otherwise, you can use this equation. This is valid when you don't have tau, that is maximum shear stress at yield. So, since it is given already in the problem, that's what we'll be using. So, that will be sigma 1 minus sigma 2 by 2 will be the tau max. Okay. They should be compared with tau max at yield point, which is anyway given, divided by factor of safety will become design equation. Okay, that's what is used in this. Just have a look. So then you will get the diameter to be 50.34 mm. Octahedral shear stress is same as von Mises stress or distortion energy stress. So same equation, we'll run through. Solve for D, that's all. So that is the end of problem number 5. Now I will run through the another problem. Okay. Problem number 6, just read out. I just run through this. So we got a cylindrical boiler of diameter. So there is a boiler. Okay, diameter is 2. Diameter of this is 2. And thickness. Thickness. Okay. This thickness is 220 mm. Okay, the internal pressure, pressure inside, fluid pressure is 1.5 megapascal, and Poisson's ratio is 0.25. Yield point is, yield point stress is 350 megapascal. So again, is asking for a factor of safety. Only difference is you have to use equation for cylindrical, you know, hoop stress and longitudinal stress. So only difference is if you longitudinal means if you take a cylinder and the element on this, this component will be longitudinal and this component will be circumferential. So this will represent your sigma x and this will represent your sigma y, and there will not be any shear. Okay, this is pure biaxial case. So only thing you have to remember, the equation for longitudinal stress is this: pressure diameter divided by 40, circumferential stress as pressure into diameter by 2t. So you can find out values. So otherwise, once you know the first principle stress, second principle stress, and third principle stress, other procedure will remain same. Only thing is we are using the total strain energy theory for 3D. So the procedure remains more or less same. Nothing to worry much. I'm just running through. Similarly, problem number 7 is given. A torque is applied. Okay, shaft diameter is given. Shaft has got a yield strength. Intention, this is okay, important here. This is important in the sense what's happening here is yield point is given, okay, but in tension it has got some value, but yield point in compression it has got different value. It means what? It is an uneven material. Uneven. So whenever you come across an uneven material, the theory to be used, ductile coulomb Mohr theory. So if he specifically ask for it, it's okay. Otherwise also you can make out by knowing that it's a yield point is a ductile material and that it is uneven material. So yield points are different in tension and compression. Therefore, the equation to be used differ. We will start with finding shear. All that I'll just run through. All that is just fine. The final equation to be used changes here. This is your ductile coulomb. This is the only equation. So once you arrange sigma 1, sigma 2, sigma 3, while discussing this theory, you have told the maximum value should be sigma 1 and the minimum value should be sigma 3. This is sigma 3. So sigma 1 is this, sigma 2 is this, the 0 will come in between. So it's something like this. 75 MPa is greater than 0 is greater than minus 75. So this will be sigma 1, this will be sigma 3. Okay, here please remember carefully, the sign is retained for sigma 3, whereas the strength part we have used modulus, of course. So we'll get to solve this, and it's an important this is the only problem where we are using a Coulomb Mohr's theory specifically. So though it is not mentioned in the problem, it is understood because the yield point values are different in tension and compression. This problem has to be solved using ductile coulomb Mohr theory only. You cannot use distortion energy or one mass stress. What is that? Maximum shear stress theory. Because if you remember, in those two theories, the ultimate the tensile properties and compressive properties are same. So you don't where to put. You will have a problem here. You see. You got two values for yield point. One is 160, another one is 180. So by looking at this, you can tell those two theories cannot be used. Only theory that can be used here is ductile coulomb Mohr theory. So I'll just run through this, and then after solving, you'll get this. So in this problem, it clearly says it's a brittle material. Procedure remains same. Okay, tensile strength is given, compressive strength is given. They are two different. So one thing is for sure that this is brittle material because it is talking about ultimate tensile strength. It's not that everything which has got ultimate tensile strength is a brittle material, but is not specified yield point. Therefore, I'm assuming that this to be a brittle material. And besides, okay, so it's a brittle material, and then the properties are different. So in brittle materials, the properties are same in both tension and compression. I'll use maximum normal stress theory. Okay. Otherwise, if there are uneven material, we can use Coulomb-Mohr's theory or Brittle-Coulomb-Mohr theory. So that's what I'll be using. In fact, yes. Okay. Here we are mentioning Coulomb-Mohr theory and modified Mohr theory. Okay. We'll find out sigma x as it is. Shear stress. From these two, we'll find out principal stresses. You can pause the video and note down the values. Okay, when do that. So this is your arrangement: sigma 1, sigma 2, and sigma 3. It's straightforward. You just take the Coulomb-Mohr equation, Coulomb-Mohr theory. Sigma 1 is this value. Sigma 3 is this value. Substitute. Then we have modified Mohr theory. Modified Mohr theory, we have three different steps. If you recollect, go back to the theory, you will find out. So three different cases when both are positive, both are negative, one positive, one negative. In three different cases, you have to use three different equations. So in this present case, one is positive, one is negative. And then again, you have to use this equation. So the formula, because sigma A is greater than sigma B, okay, the modulus is missing. You can use this equation. Okay, substitute and get the value D is equal to 25 mm. So that's all for this.